Random House Audio presents Compulsion by Jonathan Kellerman. Read for you by John Rubinstein. Cat loved breaking the rules. Don't talk to strangers. She'd talked to plenty of them tonight. Danced with a few, too. If you could call the way those losers moved dancing. The big scary consequence? A stomped toe, courtesy of a loser in a red shirt. Don't go crazy mixing your drinks. Then how did you account for Long Island iced tea, which was basically everything tossed together, and the best buzz in the world? She'd had three tonight. Plus the tequila shots and the raspberry beer and the weed the guy in the retro bowling shirt had offered her. Not to mention, hard to remember, whatever. Don't drink and drive. Yeah, great plan. What was she supposed to do tonight? Let one of those losers drive her Mustang home? The plan was Rihanna would limit herself to two drinks and be the designated wheel girl so Kat and Bethy could party. Only Bethy and Rihanna hooked up with a couple of fake-o blonde guys in fake-o Brioni shirts. Brothers, some kind of surfboard business in Redondo. We're thinking maybe we'll go party with Sean and Matt, giggle, giggle, if that's cool with you, Kat. What was she supposed to say? Stay with me, I'm the ultimate loser? So here she was, 3, 4 a.m., staggering out of the Light My Fire, looking for her car. God, it was so dark. Why the hell didn't they have outside lights or something? She took three steps, and one of her spike heels caught on the asphalt, and she stumbled, nearly twisting her ankle. Fighting for balance, she righted herself. Saved by quick reflexes, Supergirl. Also, all those dancing lessons she'd been forced into. Not that she'd ever admit it to Mother, giving her fuel for more I-told-you-so bullshit. Mother and her rules. No white after Labor Day. That made sense in L.A. She walked faster, tripped again, and Supergirl reflexes weren't enough, and she had to grab out for something. The side of a car. Not hers, crappy little Honda or something. Where was the Mustang? With only a few cars in the lot, it should have been easy to spot. But the darkness screwed everything up. Losers who owned the Light My Fire too damn cheap to invest in some spots, like they weren't making enough packing the bodies in. The bouncers and velvet ropes, a big joke. Cheap bastards, like all men, except Royal. Would you believe that? Mother finally lucking out big time? Who knew the old girl had it in her? Kat lurched across the inky lot. The sky was so black she couldn't even see the chain-link fence surrounding the lot, or the warehouses and storage lots that made up this crappy neighborhood. The club's website said it was in Brentwood. More like the hairy, stinky armpit of West L.A. Okay, there it was, her stupid Mustang. She hurried toward the car, heels clacking against knobby asphalt. When she finally got there, she groped in her purse for her keys, found them. She flicked the remote, dropped into the driver's seat, started up the engine. The car balked, then kicked in, and here we go, Supergirl. She was driving. Straight into the black night. Oh, yeah, put on the headlights. Slowly, with a drunk's exaggerated care, she coasted, missed the exit, backed up, passed through. Turning south onto Corinth Avenue, she made her way to Pico. The boulevard was totally empty, and she turned onto it. Oversteered, ended up on the wrong side of the road, swerved and compensated, finally got the stupid car in the lane. Sailing north, she felt free, like the whole city, the whole world was hers, like someone had dropped a nuke and she was the last survivor. Wouldn't that be cool? She could drive over to Beverly Hills, run a gazillion red lights, waltz into the Tiffany store on Rodeo, and scoop up whatever she wanted. A planet without people. She laughed, drove faster. At this rate, she'd be over the hill and at her apartment real soon. Stupid little dump in Van Nuys, but she told everyone it was Sherman Oaks because it was on the border and who cared. Seconds later, the Mustang sputtered, whined, stopped. She managed to steer to the right, stop just off the road. Let the car sit for a sec and try it again. Nothing but a whiny noise. Two more attempts, then five. Shit. She looked at the gas gauge. E. Shit, shit, shit. How had that happened? She could swear. Mother's voice nagged at her. She put her hands over her ears and tried to think. Where was the nearest gas station? Nowhere. Nothing for miles. She punched the dashboard so hard it hurt her hands. Cried, sat back, drained. Realizing she was exposed by the interior lights, she switched them off. Now what? Think, think, think. Okay, call Bethy's cell, and if that interrupted something, too frickin' bad. The phone rang five times before Bethy's voicemail kicked in. Cat hung up. Her phone went dead. Jabbing the power button did nothing. That brought back a vague memory of something she'd neglected. Charging up before she went out tonight. How the hell had she forgotten? Her whole body was shaking, and her chest was tight, and she was sweating. She double-checked to make sure the car was locked. Maybe a highway patrol dude would come by. What if another car did? Don't talk to strangers. What was her choice, sleeping here all night? She nearly fell asleep before the first car showed up, speeding toward her, headlights startling her. Big Range Rover. Good. Cat waved out the window. Bastard sped right by. A couple of minutes later, headlights brightened her rear view and enlarged. This vehicle stopped right next to her. A Bentley. Big, black, and glossy, that aggressive grill. And slowing down. Oh shit, what if it was Clive? Even if it was Clive, she could handle it better than sleeping here all. As the Bentley rolled to a halt, she opened the window, tried to get a look at who was inside. The big black car idled. Moved on. Damn you, rich bastard. She jumped out of the Mustang, waved frantically. The Bentley stopped. Backed up. Cat tried to make herself look safe by shrugging and smiling and pointing to her car. The Bentley's window lowered silently. Just a driver inside. Not Clive. A woman. Thank you, God. Cat said, "Ma'am?" in the syrupy voice she used at La Femme. "Thank you so much for stopping. I ran out of gas, and if you could just take me somewhere where I could maybe find a..."
"Certainly, dear," said the woman.
Throaty voice, like that actress mother liked, Lauren Hutton. No, Bacall. Lauren Bacall had rescued her. Cat approached the Bentley. The woman smiled at her. Older than mother, with silver hair, huge pearl earrings, classy makeup, a tweed suit, some sort of silk scarf. Purple, looked expensive, draped over her shoulders in that casual way that came easy to the classy ones. What mother pretended to be. "Ma'am, I really appreciate this," said Cat, suddenly wanting this woman to be her mother. "Get in, dear," said the woman. "We'll find you some petrol." Petrol? A Brit? A frickin' aristocrat in a frickin' Bentley. Cat got in, beaming. What had started off as a shitty night was gonna end up a cool story. As the Bentley glided away, Cat thanked the woman again. The woman nodded and switched on the stereo. Something classical. God, what a sound system. It was like being in a concert hall. "If there's any way I can repay you..."
"That won't be necessary, dear."
Big-framed woman. Sturdy, bejeweled hands. Cat said, "Your car's incredible." The woman smiled and turned up the volume. Cat sat back and closed her eyes. Thought of Rihanna and Bethy with the fake-o shirts. Telling this story was going to be delicious. The Bentley cruised silently up the pass. Cushy seats, alcohol, weed, and the adrenaline drop plunged Cat into sudden, nearly comatose sleep. She was snoring loudly when the car made a turn, climbed smoothly into the hills, headed for a dark, cold place. I was having lunch with Milo at the Surfline Cafe in Malibu when the call came in. No reason for either of us to be here other than gorgeous weather.
The restaurant's a clapboard bungalow with wall-sized windows and a wide plank deck, perched high on the west side of PCH, just south of Canaan Doom Road. It was
1 p.m. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.